Hey guys, welcome to the Wallifonia Music Tech Virtual Summit 2020. It's time for the second panel of the day around music tech, the IoT and voice ecosystems. What are the opportunities and challenges for media and music industry players? Our panelists of the day are Loïc Devischer, Corporate Innovation Manager at RTBF, Caroline Préviner, La Voix dans ta tête co-founder and podcast expert, and Justine Gerhardt, Voice and IoT Product Manager at Radio France. Guys, thank you very much for being with us. The stage is yours.
Okay, hi, I'm Caroline, your host for today. I want to start by welcoming everyone to this panel, and I'm gonna introduce quickly each of us. So, Justine works for Radio France, the French public radio. She is the voice and IoT product manager since 2018. On Twitter, she describes her work as designing and developing new radio experiences on voice, connected cars, and all kinds of connected objects. To explain her work a bit more of what I understood, there's a team led by Mathieu Beauval, whose goal is to prospect, learn, and determine if a subject is strategic for Radio France. And when the idea is deemed strategic, it becomes her mission to make it come true with a maximum short-term user impact. Is it okay?
Yeah, it's a great presentation, Caroline. Thank you.
Okay. Loïc works at RTBF, which is the Belgium broadcast of Wallonia Brussels Federation. Since 2004, he's an innovation manager, but he also has a background as a sound engineer. He develops innovation projects and partnership with the research and academic sector, startup, corporates, and actors in the economic development. He also co-manages an international network of more than 19 media companies and accelerators with the VRT, which is the Flemish Radio and Television Broadcasting Corporation. And their main goal is to share technology strategies and innovation mechanism between media organizations. And to introduce myself quickly, I'm a Belgian podcaster who created the first drama podcast for RTBF. I've created my own podcast studio and just launched an online magazine where you can find a selection of handpicked podcasts from all around the world and an handcrafted and familiar search engine. And the website is called lavoisdantatete.com. I want to start the conversation with a very basic question because I'm not an expert in vocal assistant and IoT. How would you describe IoT in a few words?
Yes, go on, Justine.
Thank you, Loïc. First, IoT means Internet of Things. IoT refers to all the traditional objects that we know that are getting connected to the internet. For example, a TV, a speaker, a watch, a car, a fridge, window blinds, etc. And one part of my job is to try to identify the most relevant connected objects that we expect to play radio, and I have to put our content in those new objects. So at Radio France, when we talk about IoT, we focus obviously on smart speakers, on cars, on headphones, objects that people use to listen to audio content.
Nice. Loïc, yes. Do you have something to...
Yeah, maybe just as we can also see this IoT ecosystem as a new paradigm to develop new way of delivering content and value to our users. But because as PSM, public service media, we want to be at the most of the contact points in the daily life of our audiences. And we see that this ecosystem is really an ecosystem in transformation, and there is a lot of opportunities to be more in contact in the concrete daily life for audiences, because it's really an ecosystem of the daily life. daily life. Yes.
And actually, why are those voice assistance systems emerging? What does it bring to the user, to the life of the consumers, as you said? Why is it important to talk about it?
Oh, maybe some figures. So with some studies say that, for example, in 2025, 75% of the American families will be equipped in connected speakers. We have to have in mind also that every smartphone in the world is a voice assistant in itself, because the voice assistant AI of Android or Siri are natives in these devices. So we see that the equipment rate is really high, but the question is really, why does people and when does people use it? So I think that it's really an emerging context where people see that this type of device can, and AI can make their life more easy. It's really because when they are not able to enter the finger keyboard text user experience, they will use their voice. So it's really, I think, why this ecosystem is emerging now, because people want to have more commodity in their daily lives, and AI and voice assistant can deliver it to them.
Can
I add something?
Yeah.
Just like Loïc was saying, voice is really a way for people to go faster. And I'm most of the time I'm asked if voice is going to replace, for example, mobile applications or websites. Some tasks will remain easier to perform with a mobile application. For example, if I want to discover a new podcast, it's easier to look at a graphic interface on your mobile phone, because you will have several choices that will appear immediately on the screen. And if you try to use voice to discover content, the assistant is going to ask me several questions or give me, for example, a list of suggestions. And for example, once I've heard the third suggestion, you can be sure that I have already forgotten the first one. And also the voices of voice assistants can be quite annoying. So it becomes, for example, a real nightmare to discover podcasts. So voice interfaces are emerging really, really fast, but it's not going to replace completely the mobile or the web world.
Yes, and to go further, I have also a little bit of figures, because when we ask people what they want to achieve with the voice assistant, 37% of people in their daily use use it to ask questions, just asking questions, and listen to podcasts. So discover podcasts is only 11%. So it's really reinforced what you were saying, Justine. The numbers are saying the same thing. So people want to achieve simple tasks with voice assistants.
I'm seeing something in the public media. We have RTBF, we have Radio France, and BBC just launched its own voice assistant. There is some kind of a leading force into the public media. Can you explain us why? What's your motivation? Why is it important for you? And why are you on the front end of this innovation?
You can go first, Loïc, if you want.
Okay, at the core of the why we explore this type of new user interfaces and user experience, because we want to bring our values and content and our local anchoring in a context of global transformation. So if we have to, because it's our mission, we have to be where our audience is. So we have to be present in their daily lives, as I said, or in the daily life of our community. So we really, for us, voice assistants are mean to be present in the real concrete daily live activities of our audiences and to bring them local added value, like services or information or content. So we want to have a conversation with them, and it's a way to have a conversation with them because they want to achieve things through a new UI and new UX, so we have to be there. And we can add a an innovation perspective, we have to be very active in the way the cities will transform themselves, in the way cars will transform themselves, in the way kitchen will transform themselves, because we have content about how to cook or how to make good local meals. So all these contexts are contexts that fits with voice activation, and we want to be there too.
Yeah, and for Radio France, it's the same. The first objective is to boost user retention. We want our loyal listeners to be able to find their favorite radio stations and content on smart speakers when they decide to replace their old radio set by a brand new smart speaker. And the second objective, which is the most challenging one, is to boost user acquisition. We know that our listeners are getting older and older. And we, with the voice interfaces, we are trying to develop new content, new features to attract a younger audience who has never started to listen to the radio on a regular basis.
You have also a certain freedom, an economic freedom. You don't have to have profitability immediately, which a private media would need. So you have, it's almost like you have a mission as a public media to explore all those things, which is kind of interesting. You've talked about the capabilities and the limits of the assistant, which are for podcast recommendation, it's not possible. But what can a voice assistant do in the future?
Just today, a lot of people are afraid of artificial intelligence. But I don't really think that we can say that there is artificial intelligence in voice assistants today. I work with those assistants 8 hours a day. So I can say that they can only answer to questions they have been prepared for. Everything has been pre-programmed and there is no improvisation. So today, the smart speaker can do what you want it to do. There is no real capability of improvisation. If you ask a question and they don't have the answer, they might not be able to find another answer based on their intelligence. Yeah, exactly. It's a script. Everything has been developed. So today, most people listen to the radio, listen to music, ask for the weather forecast. They play games. They use also voice interfaces to command their connected objects inside the house. But if we want to explore new areas, new use cases, we have to develop it.
Okay. A big question for me, and I think for everyone, is to understand how skills, to be specific, are distributed from producer to user. And it's the key of everything, and it's where everything is changing. And it seems like the broadcaster of yesterday, TV and radio, are being changing their roles to content creators, and the radio manufacturer is becoming the broadcaster, which you call an aggregator, if I'm right.
Yes.
So how does this work?
Yeah, you should see, for example, Alexa and Google Assistant as operating systems. In the mobile world, you have Android and iOS. and Alexa and Google Assistant are quite similar in the roles they play. Alexa and Google Assistant provide a store of voice application. So as a third-party developer, you can develop your voice application and publish it on their store and make it available to the final user. But those voice platforms also provide first-party services. So whether you can be a third-party developer or a first-party partner, and if you're a first-party partner, it means that Amazon or Google develop their own experiences, their own features, and they ask us to feed them with our content. So this is, for example, what happens today with the flash briefings. When you say, Alexa, give me the news, OK, Google, give me the news, we haven't developed anything specific. It plays France Info flash briefing. We provide them with a flash briefing, but they are responsible for the development and the user experience behind the access to this specific kind of content.
Okay. Go ahead.
No, so yeah, there is really an ecosystem where we have, like in other digital ecosystem, some gatekeepers like Amazon or Google for PSM or like us. It's really we have to have a strategic selective distribution strategy. So we have to have in mind our objective touching our audiences, and we know that this platform have need of we are content providers. We have real good content producers, and they have need. They need content to get people on their platform to distribute their user experiences. So we have to be present on some points on this platform and be able to work with them when needed. But we really have to work on our asset that is really the confidence and local partnership of our audience. It's really our added value in this ecosystem because we know that we have in front of us partners, but also enemies. So it's really we have to be careful, but we have to be there because people use these platforms. So we have to be there.
They can pull the plug on anyone at any time they want, which is kind of a weird relationship with them. It's how do you find actual balance between being a public media and having a multinational company, private company with a financial interest? It's maybe I'm wrong, but I believe it's a new game that wasn't that didn't exist before. And how do you find balance as a public media?
Yeah, it's not so easy every day to find the right balance. As Loïc was saying, we have to be present on those platforms because more and more people are using it, and it's the future of radio. And if we are not part of this revolution, we would obviously regret it in the future. But we are aware that we cannot be part of this revolution at any condition. And so we want to sign distribution agreements as often as possible. And it's true that today voice platforms are our biggest competitors because they have the control over the content they want to put forward. And if they start to produce their own content, our content, which was on the front seat, might move to the back seat. So it's not so easy every day to define a clear strategy on this specific area. Because a good balance is complicated.
As an independent producer myself, which I believe I will have to, and I want to explore skills and everything. It's kind of scary because discussing with you, I understand that to have a part in the game, you have to be a big structure. And being able to provide a lot of content, actually, a lot of quality content, something that's large. So it's kind of scary when I listen to both of you. It seems we cannot, as independent producer, find our audiences on those platforms. I cannot make a partnership with Amazon as you could. You see what I mean?
Yes.
We have to go through some kind of big structure that will...
Yes, but maybe, and Justin, correct me if I'm wrong, but there is on some part, if you are a first mover and you are a first mover on some innovative skills on some type of contents, maybe you will be, you can have an opportunity, a big opportunity to be, because if you are a first mover, you are agile enough and you are the first on some types of new UX and so on, you can be well placed on these types of on these marketplaces. So I think there is some example in France, for example, on some type of content. So
yeah, and they also organize regularly challenges. For example, those platforms identify that they lack sports skills. For example, they can organize a challenge and ask for third-party developers or content producers to offer something. And so if you win, for example, those contents, you can get a chance to have a strong position in those environments. And also something that is also possible is that, as I was mentioning, sometimes the platforms themselves develop some features, and they ask us to feed them with content. So this is also an opportunity for you, for example, to talk directly to those people and get a very visible position on those platforms.
You talked to me about a default provider, which is a big thing too. Can you explain a bit what's a default provider?
Yeah, a default provider is when you've been chosen, for example, by Google or Amazon or Apple as the best experience provider. So it means that if a user says, for example, okay, Google, give me the news, it will automatically play, for example, at Radio France, France Info Flash Briefing, because Google considers that our Flash Briefing provides the best user experience because it's short, we update it 4 times an hour, and it completely fits with the user expectation. So this is how they define default provider positions, but nothing is signed. It's just an implicit agreement. So it means that if another actor provides a better experience, Amazon, Google, or Apple can decide to plug this invocation to another kind of content. So this is there is those default provider position we are not sure to keep those default provider position forever.
That brings me to a very important question, which is what makes a good skill? Because what I've understood speaking with you is that it's difficult to understand first. And that you have to think about a basic question, the most generic question you can think about if you want to be found. So can you explain a bit about that? What's a good skill?
Yeah, but so it depends on the objectives you have behind developing skills. So I will only speak for Radio France. Maybe for Loic, it can be different. But the first criteria for us is the one you just mentioned. The skill has to be the answer for an intuitive question. For example, give me the news, tell me a bedtime story, play a Paris football game, etc. Because we want to attract a new audience to our content. We are not just trying to do customer retention. We want users to randomly access to our content by asking a general question. So we are really focusing on identifying those intuitive questions. The second criteria is that if the skill enables the user to perform a task faster than on a mobile application, because we know that people will use it if they go faster. Otherwise, it's a dead end and people won't use it. They will prefer to use our mobile application and it's okay for us. And the third criteria is that if we are able to regularly update the content we put inside our skills, we want to give reasons for users to come back regularly on our skills. So now we've understood that we need to be able to update content almost every day. So those are the three main criteria that we have and that we need to check before developing new skills.
Okay. Loic, you don't have skills for now at RTBF, but if you choose to explore what criteria would you give yourself?
So we are present on Alexa, but yes, if we will develop more and more skills, the most important thing is really the UX. So it's what's the enabler? What's the right enabler? In what context the user will use it to achieve? We have to think user-centric and design thinking is really, because it's a tricky ecosystem, because when you do a search on Google on your laptop on your mobile device, you think before what you think in by yourself before, and you will structure your requests more rationally than when you talk to a voice assistant. So it's really more difficult to anticipate what will the user do to get some information to achieve some tasks. So yes, we have, it's really an ecosystem where you have to be really user-centric and think context. What user want to achieve? What are their pains? What are the gain they expect? And give them the right enabler. What will begin the user experience? What is the catalyzer? And then what's the more fluid way to get your information or your content or your automated activities, I don't know, or your service information. So really, I think that's the most important things to have in mind.
Yeah, you cannot push content anymore. You have to think about what the audiences want and how they're going to find you.
Yes, because it's really a change in the paradigm and in the cultural way of broadcasters are thinking. Because for years, we have been gatekeepers of the broadcast technology. So we pushed our content to the people through TV or radio frequencies. But now we enter a totally another way of interactions. It's really a one-to-one interaction with people. So it's very, very different. So,
and as a content creator, thinking about UX at the start of your creative process is kind of it's also changing the game for a content producer. How do you approach each audiences, like kids or adults? Is there a difference? How do you approach them with what content and with which strategies?
What we see at Radio France is that adults and children don't think the same way, and they don't expect the same thing from voice assistants. For adults, it's a voice command, so they want to ask for content, ask for information, and they don't want to spend too much time talking to a voice assistant. They want it to go fast. But we see that for children, it's quite different. Children, we have developed kids skills at Radio France, and we've done a lot of user testing, and we see the comments on the store of application, and we see that kids love interactivity. They love when you ask them what's their name, how old they are, etc. They want to have the sensation that you're giving them choices, that they have different choices, and so they are willing to spend much more time talking to a voice assistant. So we have to deal with different user targets, and it's not always so easy, because we have to switch in our minds, to move from an adult brain to a children brain. And we see that a lot of smart speakers owners in France are families with young children. So we know that this is a good target that we can have by developing voice applications for kids.
I would like to know how technology affects content. In Radio France, you develop skills, and I'm sure it's difficult for content creators to understand the technology. So how do you develop a skill inside of Radio France?
So for us, a good user experience and a good content make a great user experience. If one of those two ingredients is missing in the recipe, it will turn into a failure. So we really have to work hand in hand. So you can make the most fantastic content, but if the user doesn't manage to launch the content, it was completely useless to invest on this content production. On the other way around, you can create the best user experience, but if the content is disappointing, your users won't come back tomorrow or the day after tomorrow, and it's also a failure. At Radio France, how do we work? When we identify, for example, a product opportunity, we go and knock at the door of different radio stations, and we see, we try to see what existing content could be used to put inside the skill, and we also identify the missing contents, and we try to work hand in hand with the radio station to produce this specific content. Because in my team, we are product experts, but we are not content experts. So we really need to work together. And sometimes what we see is that what we produce for voice assistants in terms of content has an impact later on broadcast radio, because journalists try to write differently because they got insights from smart speakers users. And so it's also a good way of changing the way traditional broadcast radio is produced.
And so you find a feature, a technological feature you want to explore, and you go to content creators to see how to exploit it.
Yeah, exactly.
What's the most difficult thing for content creators to understand? What's the biggest misconception about content creators and skills, and why when they come with an idea, it's generally not a good idea?
A lot of people at Radio France don't use smart speakers every day. They have mobile phones. They listen to the radio on mobile phones, on websites, on old radio sets, and so they don't use it. So they don't really know. They don't identify all the difficulties you can have to try to launch a content on a smart speaker. Most of the time, content producers send me an email and say, "Hey, I have a new podcast. I think it should be great for smart speakers." And I say, "Okay, it could be great, but do you have an intuitive question to get access to your content?" Most of the time, the answer is no. So it's always complicated. But what is good is that people at Radio France are very curious people. They want to discover how it works, what the future of radio is going to look like, and so they are really willing to participate to this project. It was a good surprise for me when I joined Radio France, and so it's today in the project team we have a lot of questions from radio stations, content producers, because they want to take part in those projects. So it's something that is really positive, also in terms of innovation for the whole company.
If I understand well, there you arrive with, you create a content which is very specific and with a strong identity, which is what we are taught to do. But actually, when you start to distribute it, you have to go to the most general question possible. So you have to go to the in the other way of what we are taught, which is have an identity, sell your identity, and you have to go the complete other way, be the most generic possible.
You, for example, at Radio France, we are trying to distribute our podcast. And for example, on Alexa, what we are going to do is to have one skill for one podcast. So, for example, you will have a skill named Les Pieds sur Terre, which is a great podcast from France Culture. And so we will rely on the radio station to make the promotion of the skill. So they will have to say, "Hey, listen to Les Pieds sur Terre on Alexa," and say, "Alexa, lance Les Pieds sur Terre." So they also have the possibility to distribute their content on smart speakers, but they should know that usage won't come naturally. They will have to invest on marketing, on promotion, and this is the only way for it to work and find the audience.
That's maybe, if I have to identify two main things that independent content creators should think about, it's the UX design, mm-hmm. thinking about UX when you're creating design thinking, and knowing that you have to have a strong identity, but you have to be very generic if you don't have the money to make a big campaign to promote your skill. Okay, we have 5 minutes left. And I would like to know, I have two questions left, which is, and I've answered for myself, but I would like your answer. What are the most important thing producers and technology developers should think about and know before starting to develop skills, which would be music or fictions or information, which is the most of the skills you talked about are information, which seems to be the biggest direction it's going. But what should content producers and technology developers know before starting a skill?
Just maybe at a more generic way, I think they should know that technology is a mean, not a purpose or an end in itself. And technology shapes the usage, and so it shapes maybe the user experience. So and so what does content producer and technology developers have to do? They have to work together in design thinking process, because they have to begin by knowing the end user and what the end user want to achieve in the context they want to explore. It's really the first step, and really it means working together in the same room. On the best way to do that is working together in the same room during the creation process, because it's the only way to have content adapted to the UX and the UX that fits really the need of the end user. It's more about a process or a way to work than it's more about a process and a way of working, I think.
But Justin, do you have something to say?
I wouldn't explain it better.
Okay, then. My last question is, what do you think the future looks like?
Yeah, for Radio France, we know that we are only at the beginning of this voice revolution. So we will keep on investing and exploring the most relevant opportunities for us. And today, voice assistants are mostly integrated inside the smart speakers that are located at home. But they will be more and more integrated in cars, headphones, etc. And so we also have to think about those specific contents. Maybe users will want different contents, different features. So we really need to switch from a home context to a mobility context. So this is for us what we are going to focus on for the next year.
Yes, and also that the global ecosystem will become more and more complex, and the acceleration will be more and more fast, more and more, because we see that 5G is coming. Edge computing is really rising now. So the ecosystem will be more and more complex. There will be more device, more object, more context of usage. We have smart cities that are coming to us. We have, disconnected cars that are really a complex ecosystem. I think Justin know well that, because there is manufacturer dashboards, third-party dashboards. You have people with their smartphone, with other way of and other interfaces and platforms. There is a lot of way of and platform to get in touch with content and information. So I think there is a lot of risk also for us, because we have big gatekeepers in the game. But there is a lot of opportunities also to reinvent ourselves, because as public service media, we have a challenge and we have a mission, so we have to use all the opportunities. So it's really a challenging game for actors like us in this world in transformation. So
thanks a lot. So thank you, Loic, and thank you, Justine. I think we've 1 minute left, so I would like to thank Jérôme, Alice, and the whole team at Wallifornia. And a special thanks to the technicians who works quite hard, I believe, to make this virtual summit possible. So thanks to them. Have a nice day. And thanks a lot for all your good informations.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye. Thanks.